I will tell you about course in .NET. But first we start from a general overview course technology and how it works. Also, let's start. First, let me tell a little bit about myself. I working in IT sphere 8+ years. Working as a full stack developer from 2015, working previously with Angular plus .NET, Angular 1.5 and Angular 2 plus, and I spent in SoftServe last 4 years. Not so more about myself, but the main is our agenda and course. So first I will tell about course. It will be general overview. Then we will speak about more a little bit detailed about each way of configuration course in .NET. We have at least three ways to configure it in modern technology stack. It's Azure, it's on-prem environments, on EES, and code configuration, which works on both of them. And also we will compare course with allowed hosts, because sometimes people don't understand the difference between them, and to tell the truth, I also was the same person. And at the end, we will have a small summary and questions and answers session. Course. It's abbreviation from cross-origin resource sharing. It's a mechanism in browser, which based on HTTP headers. Due to security, browsers keep a strict policy where we have same resource. It means that if you make request to the server, server retrieves requests from a resource that he shares. But if you make calls to another server from your resource to some third server, these resources could be blocked due to this strict origin policy. Here you can see the difference between this course politics turned on and turned off. When we don't configure course and just make request to some second server which we don't know and which don't know about us, we probably will get course error. If server knows about us, we receive pretty normal request from this server, and also, as you see in response headers, we will see access control allow origin, where will be our origin. If to compare those two pictures, you can see that we try to request localhost 5003 from localhost 3400. Of course, it's not only .NET feature and could be configured on all the server-side languages and even on servers like Nginx and etc. Also, reverse proxy instruments could help with that. So, if to speak more globally, not about headers, it's not security feature. Yep, course can protect you from some requests from the server to the server from browsers, but it wouldn't protect you from request postman, fiddler, or if client will just use direct link in browser. Also, course could be some kind of hack if you will use proxy on your server. It means that you set up on your machine some endpoint which will receive a link which you would like to request from second server, and will make a request with .NET tools. It will also give you a positive result, and you will hack the course. Of course, it's W3C standard. that allows server to relax the same origin policy based on headers. Also, it affects not only XML HTTP requests that we make from JavaScript, also it requests, it affects fetch. Fetch, it's a standard that W3C refers to. And fetch describes all the standard of course. So as I said previously, we will talk about configuration of cores on three different places in .NET. Here is a link to configuration on ES environments. It's a pretty detailed explanation. Also about Azure Cloud Hosted and configuration in source code, we will talk more detailed because I can't give you just a magic link where everything is described, but also we will talk about ES configuration because it's also available and developers still use it. So if to take a look on course from perspective of client and server, we can see that this is a resource that we want to request from our web server, and this resource which we plan to request from a secondary web server which probably don't know about us. If we configure it normally, we will get positive result. And if we talk more detailed about cores, we have origin header which browser sends, and we in that way understand who really originated this request, and browser could block this request to the server with this policy requirements of course. Also, if we configure it on our web server that we allow to appropriate list of origins with appropriate headers or with appropriate requests like post, get options, and etc., browser will allow to send these requests. This access control allow origin means that this origin is allowed to make course requests. Probably you also faced with that and noticed this header in responses during the web application development. If we put just zero, it means that we would like to not to follow the course politic, and we totally open our web server to all the resources which plan to ask us about information. Course consists not only from one request. Also, it has a pre-flight request. It's option request, and it checks does server understood the course protocol. It includes two headers, request method and request headers. Also, pre-flight request could be not sent if all the conditions listed here are true. Its request should be get, head, or post. There should be no request headers other than this list. Also, should be make from the browser JS. JavaScript XML HTTP request without any event listeners. It means that you don't need to expect the result from the request. No subscribers, and even if you add event listener on this your observable, it will send the pre-flight request. I suppose everything with content type and no readable stream object is used in the request, it's obviously. About credentials, course also support credentials, and by default browser don't send credentials. It could be Windows authentication, or also it could be cookies. But in case if we use this strict authorization policy, we should have this authorization, and for this authorization we have appropriate configuration in all the places where we can configure course. Also, I will tell about .NET configurations. So first it will be EES. In EES, we can allow credentials per each origin in our configuration of course model. On Azure, we have appropriate flag in configuration on app service side. On source code side, we have also allow credentials method, which gives us ability to include credentials. On RM template side, also we have appropriate flag, but I didn't add it here because Azure configuration is pretty detailed. So configuration course in cloud. Please be aware when you work in this course on Azure, because it's pretty difficult to track why course doesn't work. Be aware that this zero means that your resource opened for everyone. And even if you configure it in code and don't want to use Azure, this zero could broke all the security, because this configuration in Azure course has the highest priority, and code wouldn't work. Also, course couldn't be could be configured not only on Azure App Services UI, it could also be configured in RM templates. This way of configuration could has also pros and cons. Pros: it's could be configured during deployment, and you don't need to go to Azure App Services and do all the manipulations. It's great when you don't have appropriate access. What could be could use project variables for origin config. For origins config, it means that list of URIs, you can configure it during the process of deployment. When you have a list of projects, list of artifacts that should follow this cross-origin policy and have access to each other. Also, it has cons. It's not flexible, so you need at least redeploy. It's not it's bad when you don't when you have access to app service and can easily change everything what you need. You don't need to wait for redeploy. But also minus, it works only for cloud hosted ENVs. So if you have application which hosted on cloud and on EES, it could bring some difficulties because you need to set up a separate configuration for each of the ENVs. And also it could be changed on app services. And if you don't have access, as I said previously, you don't know why it doesn't work. So it you will require some additional help from the site. How to set up it? In RM template, in section properties, in site config, we just add course and set allow origins. Also, we can set methods and allow credentials. And also, we can set headers, which we expect from the client. Also, course could be set up on EES. Let's assume that you decided to configure the course on RM template and you have a second environment which should be hosted on on-prem environment, like a regular machine. So, pros: it's security, more flexible and simple config on my personal opinion if to compare code configuration or configuration in Azure. It's just XML, but also we have some minuses. It's not flexible, works only on EES, so twice you should configure this, and it's a little bit difficult to track. And also you need to have, you should have access at least to EES. So if you don't have access to app services, but you have access to EES, better I would say to select code configuration, which we will talk next. And configuration in source code. as the biggest minus of that configuration, it could be overridden. Overridden, it could be on ease and also on app services. So you should to be sure that you should to be sure that there are no configuration for cores, because other way it can take a little more time to investigate what is the source of that issue and fix that. And also it requires a redeploy of each time when you need to make some changes to this cores configuration. But I would say that pluses are much more better than minuses. So I would say that I prefer code configuration, and it's great. Why it's great? Because when we set up it in one place in code, we show that it works as well on prem and cloud hosted environments. It's a fast setup for all the projects. You can manage cores only in Visual Studio. And how to configure it? In configure services, you should add cores. Cores policy. Policy could be much more than one per one application, and it's useful, almost the same as in EES configuration, where you can set per each policy configuration per origin, methods, and headers. But I wouldn't recommend that version of configuration, because it's totally opens your application for everyone. But some type of that configuration, but the best is that one where you 100% sure which methods, which headers, and which URIs opened. Please be aware that in origins you should set not full URIs, just origins. It means like HTTPS two points slashes name of resource .com without slashes in the end. And also required async, you should set use course. And in use course, you add policy. It's in startup file in configure method. Be aware that when you use, let's say, MVC, in MVC, you should use it before controllers, because other way, course wouldn't work. And also, we have tricky thing. It's allowed hosts. Allowed hosts, it's a powerful mechanism which protects your application from unauthorized, from clients which you don't want to give access. It's great because you protect your application from Postman, from Fiddler, and from other tools, even from proxy on other services which would like to use your resource. Allowed host, it's just a field in configuration, but in fact, this field under the hood makes adding host filter middleware, which protects your application. On the right side of the slide, you can see the example of usage this allowed hosts. First, you can think that it's just course error, but in fact, by tracking pre-flight request, you can see that it doesn't work even for it. But in if you use course, it should work. And as the result, even in Postman, you can't get the request, you can't reach the desirable host. Please be aware, because sometimes people don't know the difference and try to configure allowed hosts as cores, or they try to use allowed hosts like just a field, but in fact it could bring problem when you configure it as allowed hosts, and it wouldn't work even from Postman, but you think that you configure it cores. Actually, I did that mistake, so please be aware. And probably I'm ready to answer your questions if you have them.